2024 so far is proving to be a very important year in scientific discoveries all across the board in many fields, more so than usual. So here are 10 recent scientific discoveries for May 2024. Number 10. Inventing Zero. The story of the digit zero is a strange one. In ancient mathematics, it crops up repeatedly, but not always in the form we think of it today. Rather, the idea of a value of nothing was common. It was just a question of how to express that. Indeed, the ancient Greeks asked how nothing can be a something. And there is some wisdom to that. But the mathematical usefulness of zero has won out in modern math. It's just too useful as a symbol. But once you know what zero means, there's almost an intuitive understanding of it. But the big question is, how did it come to be that we understand the concept at all, instead of just working only with actual quantities? Researchers working with MEG scans of living brains looked at people thinking about numbers. Interestingly, thinking about numbers up until about 9 shows differing magnetic patterns in the brain. When showing someone 0, the pattern was most similar to that of showing them a 1. The researchers hypothesized that there may actually be an evolutionary reason for this, in that it may be useful to scan your surroundings for predators. And when you conclude that there is nothing there, that may form the basis of understanding zero. Humans have taken this a step further. Many animals seem to understand the concept of nothing is there, but humans have taken it to actual mathematical levels. Oddly enough, other studies have shown that in people suffering strokes, a certain small percentage are left unable to process numbers containing zeros, but have no problem with other numbers, at least supporting the idea that different areas of the brain process different numbers, and that zero may be the hardest, most important, ingrained one. Number 9. The Self-Purifying Water Bottle. Purifying water remains an issue in much of the world. Developing countries, remote areas, areas hit by natural disasters, and so on, can have serious problems with providing clean water. Ideally, solving this issue would be to provide a method of purifying water as locally as you can get it. We have that in the form of water purification tablets and other means, but there may be an even easier way to do it. Install purification systems in water bottles. Researchers in South Korea have invented just such a bottle. It actually uses static electricity buildup from human movement. In other words, people carry around the bottle of water, and the static electricity they accumulate is used to power a tiny purification system inside the bottle. It works like this. On the outside of the bottle is a strip of metal foil that serves to channel the static electricity to a polymer electrode inside. The electrode has nanorods on it that concentrate the electric charges coming in and transmit them to the water as an electric field. This field is strong enough to kill all bacteria and viruses contained in river water in only about 10 minutes of continuous movement. What's really promising here, however, is the fact that it's cheap. Each bottle is estimated to cost only about $2 and should be fully reusable many times. Number 8. The origin of the moons of Mars. One of the many mysteries of planet Mars is just how it came to acquire its 2 moons. The predominant hypothesis is that they are captured asteroids, which they do look like. Another hypothesis, however, is that they formed much like Earth's moon and were ejected from impact events. But a new hypothesis adds another option, that they are 2 fragments of a broken up comet. The team was looking at unpublished data from ESA's Mars Express orbiter specifically regarding Phobos. It turns out that it actually reflects light more like a comet does than an asteroid, meaning that Mars's moons might be chunks of a comet, or were once a binary comet. Those are actually a thing, and a relatively recent discovery. They seem rare, but a captured binary comet would solve some of the mysteries about Mars's moons, in that both of them are orbiting Mars's equator in a way which would be difficult to reproduce with 2 asteroid captures. Interestingly, we will probably know the answer to this by 2031. Japan's Martian Moons Exploration Mission will return samples of Phobos for study here on Earth. Major abundances of things like carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen would reveal whether Phobos was once indeed a comet. Number 7. Ancient Brains. You'd think the skeletal remains of a human from centuries ago or more wouldn't contain much or any soft tissue. You certainly wouldn't expect a brain, but the brain actually is one organ that has a tendency to preserve above almost all other soft tissues. A recent study of over 1,300 cases of preserved brains as old as 12,000 years old showed that it actually happens in a variety of different environments, from shipwrecks to deserts, and it's unclear why, since the brain would seem to be an easily decomposable mass of mostly cholesterol, but they do. Many cases of preserved brains are readily explainable. Inca mummification burials basically freeze-dried the brains in the cold, arid conditions. Bog people in Europe were tanned, much like leather, and of course the tendency for fatty substances to saponify, basically turn to soap in the grave if the conditions are right, but not in these 1,300 cases. So the usual suspects as far as preservation tend to preserve more than just the brain, but many other soft tissues. With these, they were bare skeletons with brains. And this effect has been known for a very long time. There are saints that have been exhumed and found in skeletal form, but with brains, that were in days past ascribed to divine intervention, kind of partial incorruption. But the answer is probably something chemical. According to the researchers, some reaction between iron and lipids and proteins, post-mortem, might favor preservation of this nature, especially when protected by the cranium. Interestingly, the brain material, if not in an intact skull, looks a lot like soil, leading to the suggestion that forensic archaeologists may be missing an important clue in what they were trying to figure out. Number 6. A new impact crater candidate identified on Earth. While locally known since time immemorial, a feature in India's state of Gujarat had in the 20th century been suspected of being an impact crater, but for some reason was mostly forgotten in the scientific community and not well followed up until recently. Work done by researchers at the University of Kerala have found evidence that it is indeed from an impact through geological evidence, and also what may turn out to be meteorite fragments and local traces of iridium that all point to an iron meteorite having formed the crater. More work on the geology of the crater should prove it, but craters on Earth are nothing new. But this one is particularly interesting because it appears to be recent, very recent. If this is an impact crater, someone saw this form. The crater's age is in question, but appears to be about 4,000 years old, placing the impact event during the days of the Harappan civilization in the Indus Valley. Anyone living in that area that survived it would have seen something very similar to the detonation of a nuclear weapon. The crater itself is 1.8 kilometers wide, larger than Meteor Crater in Arizona, and when it hit, it would have created a shockwave damaging everything in a radius of at least 5 kilometers, and sparking wildfires that would have extended far further. It's possible that whoever was there witnessed what very well could be the only instance of a crater-forming meteorite strike of this magnitude in all of human history. Number 5. The geoengineering clock is ticking. The West Antarctic ice sheet is unusual in that it does not rest on land. Rather, it actually rests on the seabed. This means that warm water can get beneath it and cause melting. That process is happening, and unfortunately it's accelerating because the process exposes a larger area of ice as it progresses. This is bad news because if the glacier continues to collapse, it will reach a tipping point that it can't return from. That's going to see a very pronounced rise in sea levels as it unfolds, as much as a 3-meter rise in already rising seas. Once it hits the tipping point, it's inevitable. The problem is we appear to be very close to that tipping point. There are two estimates, one suggesting that it will happen within 25 years, the other is that the tipping point is around 2030, just 6 years from now. But all is not lost. There actually is a way to halt the process if we act in time. This would involve spraying aerosols into the atmosphere to slightly raise Earth's albedo and reflect more sunlight to compensate for rising temperatures. In principle, this can actually be done employing slightly increased cloud cover using ships that vaporize seawater, or simply adding sulfate into the circulating atmosphere around the edge of Antarctica to reflect light away locally. But it has to be done rapidly or it simply won't work. In other words, within the next few years, it must start. Trouble is, whenever you do something like this, there are unknowns. What happens when you geoengineer the atmosphere to mitigate an unintended geoengineering with emissions? What happens to the weather when you add 1% more cloud cover or reflective materials into the winds? All are wild cards, But any way you cut it, we have a problem with the West Antarctic ice sheet that's going to need to be addressed no matter what we do. Even if we do nothing, the seas will rise. Number 4. The neutrino detecting trees. Detecting neutrinos is notoriously difficult because they only ever rarely interact with anything. One particularly difficult one to study is the tau neutrino, and there are proposals to build detectors to further study these, particularly from astrophysical sources. But astroparticle physicist Stephen Prohira at the University of Kansas, Lawrence, proposed a novel approach that might make constructing such a detector cheaper than building it from scratch. Use living trees to study neutrinos. The idea is that any tau neutrino detector we might build is likely to require a large array of antennas. As one of the products they're searching for, indicative of astrophysical tau neutrinos interacting, are radio waves. Oddly, these detectors look something like a forest, so Prohira thought, why not just use trees? Trees can actually act as radio antennas, they will absorb it, but not very efficiently, so they would need to be wrapped in wire to efficiently function. You'd have to adjust the wiring as the tree grows, but in principle, it should work. Though there are questions about very high frequencies that a fully artificial antenna array would pick up, and the trees may not. Number 3. An interesting Mayan discovery. For all its architectural and cultural grandeur, the ancient Mayan civilization seems to have seen a lot of upheaval, both between city-state warfare and also within the leadership of individual cities. A 1,200-year-old site known as Yucanal in Guatemala yielded an unusual discovery that can have a number of interpretations, but all of them are rather disturbing because they amount to some kind of desecration of a grave. Researchers from the University of Montreal were excavating beneath a pyramid structure when they uncovered a group of bones from at least 4 different people, along with bits and pieces of their funerary goods, and they showed evidence of having been burned at high temperature. The funerary goods included parts of a burial mask that would have only been used for a royal tomb, and the careless nature in which the burned bones were buried shows not a lot of care was taken, as normally would have been for a royal burial. But this did not happen in life. These remains were burned after they were buried. One particular individual was shown through radiocarbon dating to have been dead at least a century before the burning of the remains, which happened between 773 and 881 AD. Interestingly, this correlates with evidence of the rise of a certain leader at Yucanal named Popmelil, who seems to have gained power as an outsider of the then-established regime in the city, at a time of unrest throughout the Mayan civilization at large. Researchers think that the burning may have been a ritual, symbolizing the destruction of the previous dynasty and the birth of the new one. I'm a bit skeptical of this, however. This sort of thing is not the first time royal graves were desecrated in human civilization. It's almost always done as a denunciation of that ruler or a group of rulers. I'll cite 2 examples from different parts of the world. The first is the emptying and desecration of the French royal tombs at Saint-Denis Basilica, which were opened and then unceremoniously dumped in a mass grave outside the church during the French Revolution. And to this day, though reinterred in the basilica's crypt, most of the remains of the French monarchs are a jumble of bones mixed together. The other was the tomb of the Wanli Emperor in China, who died in 1620. His intact tomb was opened by archaeologists and his skeletal remains were found. But a few years later, during the Chinese Cultural Revolution, the bones were taken out of the tomb, denounced and burned, and what was left thrown out. None of this was ceremonial. So to pin the Mayan case on ceremony rather than just old-fashioned desecration, politics, and anger would probably need a few more similar finds to be convincing. Number 2. Atoms observed acting as waves. The quantum physical world is weird. When you get into the subatomic, particles act counterintuitively to our day-to-day existence. They pop in and out of existence, quantum tunnel, get entangled in many other things that our world does not do. But the world of the large is still quantum. It's just that the effects are getting lost in the complexity and the mix of the world of the big. This line is usually put at the atom, but individual atoms can exhibit quantum effects under the right conditions. One of these is acting like a wave, in this case a type known as a wave packet. Worth noting here is that the behavior of a wave packet was predicted by Erwin Schrödinger many years ago. researchers in France recently took atoms of lithium and cooled them to near absolute zero in a vacuum, and then used lasers and magnetic fields to slow them further and arrange the atoms so as not to be too close, and confined them in a wave packet state. Then they let them go. Schrödinger had predicted that if you did that, the wave packet that could freely move would expand as time went on as part of its wave behavior. It starts as a dot and becomes fuzzy and wider. And that's what happened in the experiment. They literally saw atoms behaving as waves, exactly as had been predicted. This is a wide open area of science right now because it's very difficult to predict what sorts of quantum states of matter might be possible in all of this, or what that might be useful for. Number 1. The Vigor Crystal. This entry represents one of those times in reporting a science story that I literally get goosebumps. If you really think about what's going on with this one, you may well get that effect as well. In 1934, Eugene Vigor hypothesized that electrons could do something very strange under the right conditions. Known as a Vigor crystal, this hypothesized arrangement works like this. At room temperature, moving electrons can have enough kinetic energy to overcome the force that causes particles of like charge to repel each other. Vigor hypothesized, however, that at very low temperatures, that force would dominate, causing the electrons to arrange themselves into a crystalline lattice. This is exotic matter, and it's made entirely of electrons instead of full atoms. Sometimes known as electron ice, this material has been subject to numerous papers reporting that it had been created, but in every case there was a degree of uncertainty as to if that's really what resulted. In recent years, this moved closer to being proven, with increasingly convincing studies coming out, but it appears that the question has now been answered. Yes, Vigor crystals do exist, and not only that, one has now been photographed. This work done by a team at Princeton actually hadn't expected to actually get a photograph of a Vigor crystal with a scanning tunneling microscope. What they did was essentially sandwich the electrons between two sheets of graphene, only one atom thick, drop the temperature to near absolute zero, and then hit it all with a strong magnetic field. This was tricky because there could be no imperfections. The materials had to be perfect, or the graphene would have interfered, a problem with previous experimental attempts at creating this material. The team was just hoping to confirm the structure of the Vigor crystal, but the microscope uses quantum tunneling as a technique. So as a metallic needle scanned across the surface of the graphene, whenever it hit an electron, it would tunnel, causing a tiny electric current, allowing them to construct it into an image. Sure enough, it was a Vigor crystal, showing the exact repeating triangular arrangement that Vigor had predicted. When they applied voltage to it, the crystal melted into an exotic electron fluid, and a fluid that inexplicably formed itself into stripes. This experiment went into very exotic territory indeed. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently in a celebratory mood. When I first started this channel back in 2016, I didn't expect it to take off, and when it did, I wondered, would I have enough to talk about to make, 30 videos if people like them? This video is number 530 and Event Horizon is at 348, and I still haven't said everything. Anna and the Possum always said I wasn't succinct enough. I say no, and the LeBaron agrees. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.